Welcome to the Conscious Relationship Uncoupling and Parenting Summit. It's me, Lucia Gabriela, and your host and producer. And today we have an amazing couple. We have in Richard and Namaste, known as the Infinite Couple. They are the founders of the School of Alchemy and the School of Feminine Transformation. They are life and relationship alchemists who facilitate the transformation of the mundane into the precious, utilizing the wisdom of the ages. They are teachers, public speakers, a spiritual conduit, and transmitter. They work together, they're fun too, bringing insight using tools and techniques based on the multiple healing modalities. Over 50 years combined as spiritual leaders and a deep insight into the need of both the masculine and the feminine. They are parents of 8. That's why they're here today. Mostly adult children, lovers of the fine wine, good food, and adventurers, and can be found broadcasting live multiple times a week. You can find them at richardandnamaste.com. So welcome, Richard and Namaste, to our summit today. Thank you guys for joining us.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for having us.
Yes, we are so honored to be here.
I am very, very excited. From the moment of our conversation to co-create these together, it was so juicy and delicious. So today, we're going to be talking about how to get to happily ever after without losing yourself in the process. Mm-hmm. Which is a very important topic for all of us, especially who are in a relationship and want to build conscious relationships in their life. Mm-hmm. So we are going to start your presentation in a few minutes. Before that, we would like to learn from you guys, how do you start on this journey of conscious relating?
You want me to start? So we've been together for about 15 years.
Yes.
For nearly 15 years. And in the course of our relationship, even before we came together as a couple, we both had a high emphasis in our lives on relationships, mm-hmm. on spirituality.
On spiritual, yeah.
And we also noticed that, you know, many people in their relationships, they just couldn't, wasn't sustainable. So even if they stayed together, they didn't like each other after a few years. But more often than not, most relationships were ending between 2 to 4 years. And we both knew independently that that's not what we wanted for ourselves. We both had been married before long term. My previous marriage was for 10 years and Richard's previous marriage was for 19 years. So we both had the experience of having long lasting relationships that we felt like we were fairly conscious in, but when those relationships ended, it caused us to really reflect and say, okay, how can we do this better? You know, how can we, going into the next relationship, which we consider to be our forever relationship, we are twin flames, and, but how do we not only begin well, but create opportunities for us to continually grow together? Because I really think that is what is missing and why relationships fall apart is because people don't know how to grow together, you know? And so we really approached it from that perspective, looking at, you know, what's really necessary to make it work and you know, not wanting to have to start all over again. And knowing that, you know, I love this man with everything I am. I not only love him though, I like him and I respect him. And so that makes me want to constantly look at myself and say, you know, where can I be better, so to speak? Where can I be more effective, more beneficial in my communication and in my connection and my expressing of love in a way that makes me happy? Like, you know.
And for my part, I love her, everything that I am. And you know, our lives, we consider this is the great adventure. Mm-hmm. And we are on this journey together and recognize that, you know, we have to do it all. We have to make it work. And we are totally responsible, you know, 100% for our half of the relationship and manifesting that love every day in every way possible. And so we have our saying, which is love over everything. But over and over. So that's what we do, that's how we live, and that's how we go through our life.
Yummy. Oh, I just can tell the love and the respect and the honor that you both have for each other. So that's what, when I resonated with you, inviting you to the summit, you know, the feeling of congruency and integrity of the walking the talk. So I'm so excited for what you guys are going to be presenting to our audience today. So let's dive into the how to get to happily ever after without losing yourself in the process. So, and we come back with question and answer after that.
Okay, so we're going to go ahead and get started. As she said, we are the Infinite Couple. We're going to talk about how to get to happily ever after, from horror story to fairy tale.
Yes, how to do it without losing yourself in the process, right, which right. is, you know, something that a lot of people are very concerned about is, mm-hmm. you know, I want my happily ever after. I want a relationship that lasts. But at the same time, I do not want to lose myself. I don't want to feel like I have to worry about protecting myself and from the person I'm with.
Right. You know? Yeah, exactly.
So here we go.
Mm-hmm. So if you have failed at relationships, and many people have, you know, that you thought they were going to last, but they didn't. It's not your fault.
Yes. Yes. Or you've been concerned that maybe you can't succeed in life partnership. If that's been a concern that you've had, then you can put those fears to rest.
Mm-hmm.
You know, many people, we call them gruel sellers, which are those who teach that, you know, if just having a relationship that's going to be happy is you just need to learn how to compromise. You just need to have mm-hmm. gender neutrality and everybody just needs to do 50-50%. We say yuck to that because right. it's a really good recipe for ending up in meh.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
where it's just like, ugh, you know, so oftentimes that leads you to believing that you can't create a sustainable, deeply fulfilling life partnership or eliminate the negative effects of misunderstanding, mistrust, lack of appreciation and respect and those kind of things. And that's not true either.
Mm-hmm. So have you ever thought that there seemed to be a conspiracy in place to keep your relationship from succeeding and to keep relationships failing? You're actually right.
No, we're just kidding.
There is not conspiracy.
We're just kidding. We like to have a lot of fun. And so that's why we put that one in there. No, there isn't a conspiracy to keep your relationship failing. Actually, we're here to show you how to have a fulfilling life partnership without losing yourself in the process during this little webinar.
Mm-hmm. We've got goals. We got goals today, and we're going to share a lot of our goals with you in terms of what we're talking about. It's about how to create a sustainable, deeply fulfilling life partnership and eliminate those negative aspects.
Right. So the only way for you to create a deeply fulfilling life partnership and eliminate those negative aspects that arise when you don't have polarity in relationship is through really focusing on that positional awareness based upon masculine and
right,
feminine
right.
polarity.
Yeah.
So it's story time.
Story time.
You guys should know that Richard has been a professional storyteller yeah. throughout his life, and he's just amazing at it. So we thought we'd give you guys a little story.
Mm-hmm. It's a cautionary tale. But a long time ago, I believed in marriage. I got married, right? And things proceeded in my relationship. And eventually, the woman I was married to and I decided that we no longer wanted to travel this road together. And we ended up getting a divorce. And one of the byproducts of doing that is that I felt like a failure in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, but the good part about it, even though I received a lot of well-meaning relationship advice, you know, about people and how they are and how you have to protect yourself. One of the things that really helped me was that I doubled down on love. And I said that just because that relationship did not work doesn't mean that I'm ineligible for being happy and things are always going to be that way in my life. So in the process of discovering and doing research and really digging deep and trying to figure out what I did wrong in the relationship and why it ended up that way, I discovered a huge secret. I learned some things
that we're going to share with you that actually work to keep your relationship going and sustainable. And we met, and we started sharing our secrets of relationship sustainability with other people, and we've been doing that now for about
13 years.
Yeah.
And interestingly enough, the reason why I love it when you tell your story, because his story is also my story. We have the same story. It's one of the things that make us fit each other so well is that I also was married, was deeply in love with the person I was with, really wanted to make it work. And after getting a divorce, wondering what happened, how did I end up here?
Right, yeah.
You know, and felt really bad about it. And, you know, a lot of the relationship advice that I received during the marriage, as well as afterwards, was just non-sustainable. It just didn't work. Designed to put you back
in that same position.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. And so, you know, same story, different person. So, and that's how we ended up here. So you might be wondering, all right, that's interesting for you guys. But what does that have to do with me? And so, you know, you may not be divorced, on the verge of divorce or even in a relationship right now, but the things that we're going to talk about apply to everyone.
Yeah. Because a lot of people have a lot of trepidation, and they are sort of like, to use a sports metaphor, playing not to lose instead of playing to win.
Right.
Afraid that one day your marriage will end in failure. And even if you have, and I think the reason why we share our story is even if you had less than desirable outcomes the first time around, you know, that doesn't mean that you're ineligible from being happy, you know, finding the love of a lifetime and being happy.
Well, I love that you said less than desirable outcomes, because that's one of the things that we often bring up is, well, it's a less than desirable outcome. It's not a failure.
Right.
You know, and that in and of itself can shift everything within you if you understand that even if you've had relationships that did not last, or even if you've done, if you're in a relationship and you've done some things that you wish you had not, that's not a failure. It's a less than desirable outcome. It's a growth opportunity or an evolutionary potentiality.
Right.
So you may have read all the books on love languages and emotional intelligence, and you learned how to talk nonviolently and listen actively. These are all wonderful things, by the way.
Yeah. Taking classes on tantra, and, you know, have a bunch of crystals and yoni eggs and things like that.
Jade eggs. You got at least a dozen, right?
Right.
These are all fabulous things, but they don't work without the correct foundation. And too often when it comes to relationships, what happens is people start trying to just kind of, it's almost like trying to add a bunch of decorations to a house with where the foundation is severely lacking. It's the foundation is on, you know, quicksand, but the house is gorgeously decorated, you know, it's well appointed. and it just doesn't work. It doesn't work in a relationship. But positional awareness has been a technique and a tool that makes relationships sustainable. And that's what we're really about, is conscious relationships that are sustainable.
Right.
You know, there's nothing that says those two ideas are mutually exclusive.
Exactly.
So there we go.
So we're going to talk to you, and we're going to give you three things that are going to help you in your either pursuit of having a conscious relationship, or if you're already in a relationship, to make it deeper, more profound, even more juicy for you.
Yeah, and finding out these, you know, sharing these secret potions, which ones to share and everything was really challenging for us, because, you know, we teach retreats, you know, where we teach for 17 hours straight. And even during that, we don't cover nearly as much as we want to be able to offer.
Right,
so trying to find three things that we can give you guys in, you know, a very short period of time was a little challenge, but we were up for the task.
Yes. So secret one, how to return relationship gruel into creme brulee. Number two is how to discover hidden jewels in a former and current relationship pain. And number three, how to know that this person is in fact the one for you.
Yes, that's a big one. How do I know that they're my one? Okay, number one, how to turn relationship gruel into creme brulee. Why creme brulee, you may ask? Because Namaste loves creme brulee. So
much tastier than gruel.
And no one loves gruel. Although if you enjoy gruel, I respect your choices.
Right.
I'll take creme brulee any day. So you may be thinking,
right, I don't understand how positional awareness based on masculine and feminine polarity is going to work for me. So we have a quick story. I'll go a little bit more in depth in terms of what happened in my life, right?
The horror. Dun, dun, dun.
Well, you know, I spent a lot of my career when I was in corporate in being an activist of one sort or another. I did a lot of work in diversity. And what I didn't realize is that activist kind of worldview, mm-hmm. you know, had also crept into my outlook or my looking back on the pain that I had in my relationship. And mm-hmm. I actually had a love affair with past pain. I had erected this shrine, if you want to call it that, to past pain. And I felt that everybody did stuff fueled by hurt, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. We had a lot of conversations about that. You know, I believed in my heart that relationship pain was somehow connected to a larger conspiracy in society to subjugate and emasculate men. And I would spend a lot of time ranting and raving about that. You know, it's like, it was very weird. You know? So, and I bring that up because I want you to understand that many times it's an evolution to consciousness. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you've got to get rid of all of that gruel. Right?
Right.
Before you get to the creme brulee.
Right.
I believe that relationships were a form of indentured servitude, especially right. on behalf of men. And, but you know what? There was a transformation that happened because of my relationship with the all that is, with the divine. Eventually, I had to realize that holding on to that was hurting me a lot more than it was helping me. Mm-hmm. And in order for me to grow and develop and actually get to the good part of my life, I had to, I realized there was something missing. And that's when I found the truth of positional awareness. Not just as, you know, something to staple on and say, okay, yes, I'm conscious, mm-hmm. you know, and I know what's happening, but that it was a foundation
right.
for our relationship.
Right. And that positional awareness is based on a fundamental idea, which is that we as humans, science has supported this as well as every spiritual practice and psychology has supported this, that mm-hmm. we desire more than anything a life of meaning that's built into our humanity. Mm-hmm. And one of the foundational elements of having a life of meaning is a sense of place,
yes.
knowing our place.
What is my place? Right.
Where do I go? What do I do? What is the place that I occupy? Mm-hmm. But in most societies, there is an identified sense of or ready-made sense of place for mm-hmm. each individual in the relationship.
Absolutely.
Even yeah. in societies where, you know, where there's a huge degree of polyamory, mm-hmm. even in societies where there are, you know, beyond the gender binary into mm-hmm. three and four, there's still and this is the place that you occupy.
Right.
However, in Western society, we don't have that. Mm-hmm. And so that tends
Well, we have the idea that everybody's place is
everywhere. And yeah. and it's based on, and while it sounds great, it's not how we work as people. Mm-hmm. And so positional awareness is all about creating a sense of place in your relationship where you understand what your place is, where you occupy. Mm-hmm. And that, and in ours, in the way we teach it, it's also based in, or our great work is in basing it in also masculine and feminine polarity, because polarity creates passion in a relationship.
Right. Yes.
So now you have a sense of place, mm-hmm. you have your position, and you have your passion based on polarity.
That creative
lots of
tension. Right, yeah.
lots of peace there, but it really does work. And I kind of wanted to spend a little bit of time talking
yeah.
about that.
Mm-hmm.
For those of you who are new to our work, so you can get an idea of what we mean when we say positional awareness based on masculine
yeah.
feminine polarity,
yeah.
which
yeah.
may not seem as obvious to everyone else as it is to us.
Now, one of the things that we have discovered when we uncover these truths and we share them with people for the first time, typically what happens in many cases is that you get a case of the powerful yeah buts, right?
Mm-hmm.
And those powerful yeah buts is when you have, you know, that little bit of resistance that comes up and says, well, yeah, I know, I see you guys and you're all happy and everything, but I don't know how this positional stuff is going to work, you know, based on masculine feminine polarity. How is that going to work for me? Keep my relationship from becoming toxic.
Keep my needs.
Keep
make
me
sure my
from
needs
being
are
taken
met.
Advantage of.
Make me happy.
Make me happy. How does that happen? And it is true that we are ecstatically happy. And it is true we have a conscious relationship. But you know what was even more true than that? Is that the best way to relationship success is to model what works, what
right.
what is proven time-tested relationship constructs that go beyond culture, societal norms, mm-hmm. and any sort of political agendas.
Yeah, see, in the business world, we call that swiping what's working, right? Yeah. And so, you know, that modeling of relationships has been historically throughout the history of humanity has been how we did it, mm-hmm. you know? And so that is the truth. And so you can trust in that, you know, time-tested relationship constructs. These things go beyond culture. They're all over the globe.
Right.
So that's why that works. Mm-hmm. So number that, and that's why it turns it from gruel, from meh, from mm-hmm. oh, it's just like, to creme brulee.
Yeah, understanding what your place is is critical to having that really juicy, delicious relationship.
So secret number two is how to discover hidden jewels in your current and former relationship pain. And I don't know anyone who's never, I think I've only met like maybe one person in mm-hmm. all my years of living who said, I've never experienced hurt or pain in a relationship. Like, I don't know anyone who does their story, really. So you might be thinking, and this is really true of for those of us who, you know, our path is one of consciousness, evolution, enlightenment, mm-hmm. and things of that nature. We like to do our work, right? Yeah. It's a thing.
Yeah.
So you might be thinking that you're too broken, or I need to do more self-work, or, you know, things of that nature. So let me tell you a quick story. Mm-hmm. This is my story, and I call it the myth. I had trust issues, serious trust issues. Mm-hmm. My mother was married, it said it's 8 times, but actually I counted after I made this live, it's actually 9. My father was not present in the home as I was growing up. In fact, we only recently began to have a relationship. My ex-husband was unfaithful to me multiple times. And I had only been divorced for a short period of time when we met. Mm-hmm. So I had, and while I had done a lot of internal work on myself, I realized, and this is really the important thing, is that I realized that there are things that I would not be able to do without another person. In other words, your self-work, your work on yourself by yourself can only mm-hmm. go so far.
Right.
Because there are certain lessons that you don't learn until you're in a relationship. There are certain lessons that you think you've learned that mm-hmm. you don't really know that you've learned until you get with another person.
Yeah,
you know, you think, oh, I'm so understanding and I'm so calm and rational. And then that other person comes and they do something that hurts you. See if that's true or not.
I think that's one of the hallmarks of that twin flame and that conscious relationship, right? Is that not only is this person going to make you ecstatically happy in a lot of wonderful ways, but they're also going to rub against you in the areas that most need polishing, mm-hmm. as Rumi would say.
Yes.
So they're ideally suited for that. So you have to look out and be conscious of that as well, right?
Right.
So not all, you know, epiphanies and glorious sunshine. Some of that.
That's what I was hoping for. But it is now. But,
right,
you know, at the beginning, especially, you know, there was a lot of, wow, okay, we have to learn how to fit together. Mm-hmm. And so the idea that I needed to be perfect or totally fixed, you need to be completely done with your work mm-hmm. in order to be worthy or eligible for a relationship is simply
it's just not true.
So you might be thinking
another case of the yeah buts.
You got
right?
the yeah buts.
You don't know me, right? I'm a piece of work, right? I'm not whole enough, healed enough, worthy of a relationship, trusting enough, right? Still mm-hmm. have trust issues, mm-hmm. maybe have a lot of scars from that previous relationship. You know, here's the secret. We have a saying that, you know, it's a gift in everything.
Every single thing.
And all of your past and present relationship pain is actually a hidden gift. It adds value and benefit to who you are and what you offer to the relationship. You just need to know how to access it.
Right.
You know?
So like in my situation, I was like, oh, I have trust issues. I have a challenge with, then I changed that and said, okay, I'm trust challenged. I have an interesting relationship with trust. And at some point I realized, you know, in the course of delving into that, you actually said, you know, trust is a choice. You said, I'm trustworthy. When you trust me is up to you.
Right.
And it was a revelation that I would not have had if I hadn't had the trust issues to begin with, mm-hmm. which was that, you mean I can choose? I choose what I trust? I thought trust was just something that kind of like came up on me.
Right.
You know? And so it was the first
somebody
time.
Somebody has to make you trust makes them.
Right.
And it was deeply, how they can be trusted.
Right. Yeah. And it was deeply empowering. It was like, oh, wait a minute. It's in me. I decide. Mm-hmm. I can choose. I don't have to be held hostage. So that's an example of that past pain actually being a hidden gift, because now people actually ask me, you know, how are you so trusting? That's just amazing. I could never. And I'm like, oh, yes, you can.
Yes, you can. You can absolutely do that.
So secret number three, and this is the big one. Everybody always wants to know this. How to know
that they are the one for you. We get this question probably more than any other. And you may be thinking, I don't know how to know that they're the one, or how to tell if they're the wrong one.
<You know? laughs> So let's unpack that a little bit.
My parents were married for over 30 years, you know, but initially when I was a young kid, my dad struggled with alcoholism. And eventually he had a spiritual epiphany, and that changed the whole trajectory of his life. And so my mom stayed with him throughout that process, you know, in the really, really bad times, mm-hmm. and then also in the really, really wonderful times. Right. And so you look at that, and I think the prevailing wisdom now would be, when things get rocky, you need to get rid of that.
Especially if he's an alcoholic.
Right.
Yeah. She should have left a long time, but no.
No, but you know, my mom, you know, she would tell anybody who asked, and she did a lot of teaching about relationships as well. And she said that, you know, my dad was the one for her, the only man she had ever been with and the only man she was ever going to be with. And so she stayed the course.
Yeah.
And they actually were the one for each other.
Right. And you know, my mother, while she's had so many relationships, I really appreciate about her that she keeps trying. She's willing to keep trying,
mm-hmm.
you know, because I know a lot of people would be like, oh, I've been married twice, I'm never going to get married again or something like that.
Right. Yeah.
But the interesting thing is that all the men that she has had relationships, or most of them, are now in long-term happy marriages now, even though they couldn't make it work with her, right? Mm-hmm. So the telescope here, and we say the telescope because we always say that sometimes people are looking through the wrong end of
right.
the telescope.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so a lot of times we're looking and saying, are they the one? But really what we want to look at and say, am I the one? Mm-hmm. Because I have to be the one in order for things to work
right.
out. And sometimes that's a little bit of an ouch to try to turn that around and be like, it's me.
Right. Right.
Hey, look at me.
Right. Because all of the prevailing wisdom, right, tells you, you need to find out figure out who they are and how they are the one. But really, it's about you.
Right. You don't have to be Sherlock Holmes, right?
No.
So you might be thinking, I don't know how to trust myself mm-hmm. or forgive my ex, or maybe even forgive my current partner.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how to stop being attracted to other people or fantasizing about being with someone else. And you'd be surprised at how often that comes up for men and women.
And women, yeah.
I don't know how to get out of my fantasy.
Right.
But, you know, the reality is this. Even when people end up broken up, a lot of times in marriages, a lot of people reconcile at least once,
mm-hmm.
right? Even if they separate. But there's one consistent factor that matters, and that's forgiveness and gratitude.
Right.
How you see your partner is the biggest causative factor to success or failure. Not education, not money, and not even attraction. So, you know, what you want to know is, and what you really want to pay attention to is, it's easy to identify whether a person is the one. And all it has to do.
Yeah, it's got to be about forgiveness.
It's always about forgiveness.
Yeah.
And forgiveness is what makes them the one.
Yeah.
You know, concern that they are not the one is based upon lack and judgment
mm-hmm.
and fear. So those are our three secrets that we wanted to share with you.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing about it is, if this has been really enjoyable to you, if this has even begun, just if you got one little morsel to chew
right.
on,
yeah.
you know, you can find out so much more about what we do, about what we offer. We have the School of Alchemy. You can see it at the bottom of your screen, schoolofalchemy.love. The School of Alchemy is a space where it's actually comprised of three schools.
Yeah.
Right, which is the business school, the
mm-hmm.
mystery school, and also the life alchemy
school.
And the
life alchemy school, yeah.
And so when you go into there, you get these three different schools. You get
mm-hmm.
an opportunity to explore them. You get an opportunity. There's lessons and teachings in all three of them. And it's all under that School of Alchemy. So in the life alchemy school is where you would find a lot of the lessons about relationships and about how to connect deeply to your partner. Also in the mystery school, what we like to do is we like to take the mysteries. Now in the mystery school, we go into, you know, these kind of esoteric, deeper metaphysics practices and processes.
Mm-hmm.
And then what we like to do is actually show you how to apply them to your business in the Biz Alchemy School, and then to your life, including your relationships in the Life Alchemy School.
Right.
As well as it's under the umbrella of the School of Alchemy, but it's separate at the same time, is the School of Feminine Transformation. Mm-hmm. And in the School of Feminine Transformation, we actually have a wife school that goes into all of the different components of how to create a relationship, how to be the position of a wife, which is kind of unheard of. Like it's a position. But I think that looking at it as a position actually elevates it, mm-hmm. instead of just seeing it as something that, you know, well, I got with this person and we walked down the aisle at one point. So now, you know, I guess that's what I
am.
We're
here and we're doing it.
Right. You know, looking at it and saying, okay, what's here for me and what do I offer to it is wonderful. And so that's in the School of Feminine Transformation, which you can also find on schoolofalchemy.love. So thank you guys so much for your time. I hope that this has really helped you all so much. Mm-hmm. And we'll talk to you next time.
That was an amazing presentation. Thank you so much. I learned a couple of things today and some of that resonated so well. I really appreciate you. How do you, I love what you guys brought into the conversation, because I believe this is the first time I really hear about positional awareness. Mm-hmm. And I love what you said about creating a sense of place in your relationship. And I know that you talk a little bit about it. My question is, we're living in times where we have the feminine and the masculine, but also we have in experiences where we feel like we are both at once, and like we are the whole aspect of the whole aspect of the energy is like, and even the sexes and the polyamorous and LGBT communities and transsexuals and pansexuals and all these other different, even binaries and all the different ways of experiencing sexuality, mm-hmm. is a very, it's becoming, you know, new now. It's like, it's this form that is creating and it's like exploring. And, you know, now it feels like being the feminine, the masculine is a beautiful energy, but also it's like, it's kind of like, in my belief, it's like, from what I'm seeing, it's kind of like being something from the past that is like, that is still being talked about and still people have no idea how to, but it's this new age of this blending in somebody's life experience or sexual experience, because we can feel both and we can sense both. And at one point it feels like one. I don't know, that's my experience where I can feel, mm-hmm. the energy is so close and so, but it's like this like one tiny little degree different, because I'm still human, right? I'm still there. So I can feel the energy. And when you have we have in the audience people who are in different type of relationship, and the gay community, lesbians, all of it, and the LGBT community, when it comes to the positional awareness, you know, creating a sense of place in your relationship, what do you have to say a little more in depth with in this?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that from a standpoint of positional awareness, it is, you know, diving deep. There's so much to offer in terms of how we show up, mm-hmm. for each other. And I think that when I am fully invested in my masculinity, that allows that creative tension between us to flourish, mm-hmm. because I don't feel like I have to do it all.
Right.
Like I tell a lot of folks that when I want to get in touch with my feminine, I just reach over here and I touch namaste, because she occupies that feminine pole, yeah. and that's delicious and that's juicy to mm-hmm. me. Mm-hmm. And so it feels good to be different.
To be different from each other.
Different and distinct, right. and have different ways of looking at the world, have different ways of mm-hmm. of occupying, different ways of showing up, mm-hmm. and that's delicious and that's juicy, and that mm-hmm. that contrast, mm-hmm. I think, is everything.
Right. Yeah. And what we found is, because in our schools we have people of many different sexual orientations, mm-hmm. and even gender identities. We have trans people. We have we have gay people and lesbians, and we and polyamorous people and non-polyamorous people. So we have all kinds.
A broad spectrum.
Broad spectrum.
Yeah.
And everybody finds something that they need there, because that positional awareness is a human characteristic. It's not a heterosexual monogamous characteristic. But I think that, you know, sometimes there's a tendency to want to throw out the baby with the bathwater. Mm-hmm. And so because we have the freedom to say, I can be everything. I'm every woman. It's all in me. I can do everything. I can be everything. Once you have that freedom, then the next question is, now what is the most beneficial for me? What's mm-hmm. going to allow me to be who I desire to be in a way that is non-depleting, in a way that can honor others, and in a way that actually creates more appreciation? And that doesn't usually happen from a monoculture. It happens through a more diverse stance, because by Richard being masculine, it means that he's doing things in the relationship that I'm not doing. That increases my level of respect and appreciation for him, because he's doing what I'm not doing, mm-hmm. and vice versa. And so I get to just relax a lot more. You know, and that's why we started teaching it, is because people would say, well, you are so relaxed and he's mm-hmm. so content. And why is that? And when we started teaching it to people, even people who were initially like, I don't know, some of our students were very like, I don't know about that, but they were like, I need something. And so they started right. doing it, and they were shocked, like, oh my goodness, this does make a huge difference. And I'm like, yeah, because you don't have to do it all. And to prove that you're powerful. You know, right. you can just yeah. kind of say, all right, this is my position. So if someone said, well, I'm not into the masculine feminine thing, I'm more gender neutral, then I would say, okay, well, you still in your relationship want to identify your positions. What is your position in the relationship, and what is your partner's position in the relationship? Because that positional distinction creates the tension, and that tension is what keeps the relationship going.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Great. I love this. I love your presentation, by the way. It was just fun, interactive, entertaining. I love it. It was awesome. When we come to the last part that you said, I wanted you to repeat. I will desire for you to repeat the question that you asked about what is the most beneficial for me mm-hmm. to be in the relationship that I don't feel depleted? If I get that right, that's the question.
Yeah, you get, because when I know what is the most beneficial thing? So what is it that I can offer to the relationship that's going to meet the needs of my partner, that's also feels really good to me, because both of those things matter. Mm-hmm. And what is it that my partner is offering to the relationship? And you need to ask them, not assume, you know, what is it that you want to bring to the relationship that feels good to you and also is an offering to me? By that being different between what he's bringing and what I'm bringing, that gives me a place to appreciate him. Whereas with a lot of couples and a lot of relationships, what happens is competition. Right. And you only are competing because you're mm-hmm. doing the same thing. So who does the dishes the best? Mm-hmm. Who does the finances the best? So it becomes this kind of, well, I'm better at it. And mm-hmm. you don't want that in your dynamic. But if we're doing different things, there's no place to compete.
Right. Yeah.
If I'm the person in some relationships, it might be the feminine who cooks. In other relationships, it might be the masculine who cooks. There's precedence for both. Mm-hmm. But there's no like, well, who's the better chef? You know, it's more like who enjoys it more. And then the other person may say, okay, well, you know, I'll do the cleanup or I'll do the organization. But it's not a constant negotiation. I think negotiations should be left in the corporate boardroom. Because in a lot of negotiations and in a lot of compromise, the focus is on somebody's not going to get what they want.
Right, yeah.
And in
yeah.
positional awareness, it's we're highlighting what it is that we love as opposed to focusing on what we don't have.
Mm-hmm. And one of the things you said, I think, really jumps out to me is that both parties are looking from the standpoint of what can I give?
What can I give?
As opposed to a lot of relationship models, the admonition is, protect yourselves at all times, like you're in a boxing match. You know? Keep your arms up, protect yourselves at all times.
Right.
And also look out for what you can, what you're being offered. What right. can I get?
What can I get? Yeah.
What
right.
are they offering? But if you're approaching it from the standpoint of what can I give, then, and you have that mutual respect, then that also, you know, passes through your desire and all those other yummy things can flourish, because now you're being celebrated. instead of seeing, you know, playing this chess game where each person is trying to look out for their own self-interest.
Or being told to be like the other person. Be more like me.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I'm loving this conversation because this is important. It's about conscious relationship and really how to create conscious awareness and build a great foundation for to really be happy after. Right? So I love the aspect that you mentioned, the aspect of like, don't go with the aspect of with the plan of negotiating, because always in negotiation, always something is gonna lose or not get what they want or desire, like you said. That was a great point in there. So from what I'm hearing, and I think I'm hearing it clearly, is that coming to the table to share what it is that you really desire and love to do in a relationship, what is really that you really eager and driven for and excited to share and to offer in the relationship, and have the both, right, the couple or the threesome or how many they desire to be, to see what it is that they bring it into the table. So that sounds delicious. So what if, you know, what everybody's bringing to the table is yumminess and deliciousness and all this stuff, and it's all like beautiful and some, you know, at part of so many things that need to be done or achieve, or I don't like to use those words, but anyway, I'm using them, that they need to be, you know, like daily life, like washing the dishes and doing the clothes and paying the bills and, you know, doing the lawn outside and all those daily tasks that sometimes can get couples into that bitter and resentment and that anger and those feelings that this doesn't feel good. So what if those things are not part of the sharing and the offering? It is not on the table. So who's going to do them?
Well, they are, but I mean, as the way we teach it is that is an intrinsic part of going through and seeing what the positional awareness is. It's actually what we teach it as is a system, and it's the positional awareness integrated relationship system. It's the pair system. And so what you're doing is you're saying, okay, now you're going to look at the various areas of your life, and that's going to be different for each person. Some people will be in a monogamous primary relationship, right? And other people may be in a secondary relationship, a polyamorous secondary relationship or tertiary relationship or something different. But you're going to look at the areas of intersection between you and this person. Where do our lives share that is impacted by our relationship? And you're going to look at the whole of that and then break it down. So let's say we look at the house, the running of the household, since that's what you brought up, right? Mm-hmm. You're going to look at the distinction between who's going to have authority over what. That person who has authority is the person who is the decision maker about what's going to happen, because that's the person that has authority in that area. The other people in the relationship or person in the relationship is the supporter of that area. So it's never like that's your thing, I don't want to be bothered with it. It's you're the authority. I offer the support. I offer the counsel. I offer the what I see or the noticing or what have you. The person who is authority, depending on how many people you have in your relationship, may delegate responsibility to another person.
Exactly.
So they may say, yes, I'm in charge of, you know, making sure that the house, for instance, the outside of the house, all of the outside maintenance, the gardening and all of that stuff. My authority is in there and deciding what's going to go on and what needs to happen. However, maybe this person is in a relationship and they've got Jane and Bruce. They might say, okay, well, but Bruce, I'm going to need you to do so-and-so. And Jane, I would like it if you do so-and-so. And so there's an interconnectedness there, but the authority always remains with the person who is given that authority. So everybody knows who's in the position there, as opposed to what happens in most relationships, which is
somebody starts doing it.
Somebody starts doing it and they're resentful, or why doesn't anybody ever help me? Or nobody does it because it's nobody's responsibility. Mm-hmm. And so then it just doesn't get done. And then everybody's irritated. You decide who's going to be the person. And you may say, you know, let's try it. Nobody really wants to do this task. But we're going to give this person, you know, 6 months to do it, and then we'll come and
revisit it
and see how it's working and how it's going, and see if we need to change. So nothing is set in stone, mm-hmm. but it is a, you need to know that the universe functions under the guise of organization and formation. And we need that within our relationships too. We need to know, what am I doing? What am I supposed to be? Bruce is in charge of that. So I don't have to worry about that. And I can give Bruce appreciation for doing that.
Mm-hmm. So authority. So who in the relationship is in the authority of a specific area of the life of the relationship, of the finances, house, children, mm-hmm. and all that stuff. What if there's... let's talk about a couple, both of them are in this, they feel that they are in the same authority for a specific aspect of life, like just at the house, like both of us feel like, no, I'm the authority in this area. Going out.
That's a
very good question. And I think that one of the things that we talk about in our system is having the values discussion, you know, where we actually talk about the things that, what are our values? What do we value? And many times we assume that we know someone else's values because we just put good, you know, you have good values? Well, sure, yeah. I've got good values and so do you. Mm-hmm. We both have good values. But we actually have a process where you can go through and identify what your values are mm-hmm. and then come together and actually be able to look at those and dig into those. And so that helps a lot in terms of identifying who's going to do what and, mm-hmm. and how that's going to be structured. Because while we may have expertise in something, right? Like for instance, in my background is in interior design, but Namaste is an artist. And so we could actually look at it and say, well, wait a minute, you know,
we both have something
to offer with respect to this, but in terms of our respective values, right? One of my values is, you know, say I have a value that says, you know, I like to see beautiful things. I may not necessarily want to do it, but I like to really, really see it, right? I have an appreciation
of
for beauty, right? And then what if he has that as a really strong value,
right.
You know, that things be beautiful.
Right.
And so even though we have similar skill sets, I would look at that and say, you know what? No, you're the authority in terms of what is beautiful.
Right.
I have my values and appreciation for
that. I appreciate you.
And
right. So what we tell people to do and how we teach them how to do it is there's a conflict, we start unpacking that as mm-hmm. to why it's a conflict. Yeah. Usually when two people both say, I want to be an authority, it's usually because one or both of them has a fear mm-hmm. of not getting their needs met, of not being valued. You know, sometimes it comes from our jobs. Like if I wasn't the boss and somebody was mean to me or something like
right,
that. So they want to, you know, I need to be in charge of it. And when you really look at it and you say, okay, do you enjoy all the things that comes with being in charge of that? Mm-hmm. Do you enjoy having all the weight on you of that? Does it light you up? A lot of times they'll back up and they're like, well, actually, no. I don't really like
so
that at all.
Not getting
yeah, you know, that. And then they're like, I'm like, you're not talking about someone that you don't know being an authority. You're talking about this person that you love, that you're making a life with, mm-hmm. being the final word. That doesn't mean that you don't have a say. It doesn't mean that you can't express how you feel and that they don't care about how you feel. It's just a question of, for ease of communication and for, you know, ease of the relationship flowing, who's in charge. And every single time, I mean, so far, I mean, we've worked with like hundreds of couples. Mm-hmm. Everybody's always can figure it out. Like, okay, yeah, I've been in authority there and I really didn't like it. And then the other partner's like, you didn't? I thought you wanted that, you know? And so usually you have these aha moments where people are like, can't wait to let go of stuff that they were mm-hmm. doing, but they really didn't love.
Right, it wasn't surfaced to the area of consciousness.
Right.
So you could actually have a discussion about it. We just came into the relationship with a host of assumptions and a host of pre-programs mm-hmm. that were running. And so then we end up doing things that we don't like to do.
Right.
And then we feel put upon. And then eventually mm-hmm. that solidifies into resentment. And mm-hmm. now, you know, we got a low grade attitude. And it's like, what's wrong with you? Well, nothing. It's like, well, I thought you liked that. Well, we never talked about it. And it's like, well, not long. Well, it's been years.
Right.
And we haven't talked about it. But in our system, what we teach people is how to surface those things in a gentle way and how to have those discussions and not take the things personally, mm-hmm. and how to recognize that it's never me against you. It's always me and you against the issue problem. Or the mm-hmm. problem. Mm-hmm. And that changes everything when you start to really examine it.
It really does.
I'm loving this conversation. I know that we can have multiple of this. So, and from what I'm understanding better, and I'm like loving it, is the positional awareness comes from a place of the aspect of feeling the joy and the juiciness of being, you know, of what can I give in the relationship, coming from that place mostly, like coming like, what can I offer? But at the same time, honoring mm-hmm. ourselves, where is, well, it has to feel good, it has to feel orgasmic, delicious for me to be in that position as a giver. And at the same time, it's beneficial. So what it is that even though that I'm giving, I'm coming and I'm doing things, being and giving from a place of like being unconditional and just, oh, that unconditional giver, honoring my boundaries too, at the same time honoring myself and my self-love and what feels good to me. Mm-hmm. And from this place, I love, Richard, that you talk into the aspect of values, because it's something that I also share with my clients, is the aspect of, if we don't know our values, we have like a chaos of our life, because it's just seems like we're going everywhere in different directions and we are not really focused. So I love that you brought that. So when we merge in, it's like this delicious orgasmic cocktail, pretty much, of, you know, being the conscious giver and, you know, the conscious be beneficial for me, and that feels good and delicious, and coming from a place of my values. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it sounds practical, and it sounds like very, it sounds good. It feels good. I thank you so much for that. And the last thing I wanted to remark also here is, put a postmark here, is when you said about trust is a choice. Mm-hmm. And I love you said that, you guys mentioned that, and I resonate with it so much. In my experience, I believe that we are in our power to really trust, and it coming from inside out, and it's a choice. It's just totally a choice. So I really thank you for pointing out. If there's something else you want to share about trust as a choice that it could be beneficial for our audience today, before we wrap it up.
I think that, you know, in my experience, recognizing that I could choose to trust, like I was saying, it was a rush. It was like I had like boop, 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 all of these moments of clarity all of a sudden that I didn't realize that it was in me, that I could choose that. Mm-hmm. And it gave me the freedom to decide trust or no, right. But recognizing that it's up to me, and that's a very powerful place, versus feeling like I'm waiting for other people to do something or to not do something, to disappoint me. Mm-hmm. Because of that, the most amazing thing has happened as an outgrowth, because it didn't just extend to our relationship with each other, it began to extend to everyone. So even when someone does something and I go, you know, I really didn't expect that them to do that, I never really see it as a trust thing. It becomes mm-hmm. just an issue of, they did something I did not expect, and what do I want to do in response to that? And that deep inner trust has not moved. And I think a lot of mm-hmm. people are struggling with trusting themselves because they see trust like that. But once you really internalize it as a choice, you always trust yourself, even if you end up with a less than desirable outcome.
Right, absolutely.
It doesn't mean that you don't trust yourself. You're like, oh, okay, yeah, I didn't really expect that. That's not really what I wanted. Okay, what am I going to do next? As opposed to that happened, so therefore something must be bad, something must be wrong, you know, and becoming like this negative cycle. So trust is such a huge, that self-trust and that knowing of choice, the trust choice paradigm is such a huge thing.
Yeah. We've grown up with this notion that the worst thing possible is for us to be wrong about anything. And so many times we're always in that doorway where we don't know what to do or what not to do because we're so afraid of being, you know, less desirable outcomes. You know, I put my trust in it and then what I desired didn't happen. And so what we encourage people to look at their lives and say, what if you couldn't get this wrong? What if every decision you made had something to offer to you, no matter what the outcome was? If you look at that, then you relieve a lot of pressure off of yourself and you can actually explore the freedom to trust, because many times when folks are having that internal angst and that headache, it's because they haven't made a decision one way or the other.
Right.
You know, they're just they're just standing right in the doorway, either coming in or going out. Now, you know, when you were a kid, your mom said, that's not cool. You know, you got to either go outside or come in. You can't just stand in the doorway. And so I think it is with trust. It's like once we get to a point where we can trust ourselves and recognize that, you know what, I'm gonna do it. Life is for the living. Yes, we can do that. We can trust. And when you desire that and when you want that and when you're looking for good outcomes, the universe tends to respond with what we desire
what
most.
We desire, yeah.
And so that is, so trust, it becomes its own self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yes, it does.
The more you do it, the easier it is, yes, and the better it happens. And the more you do it, then the easier it is and the better outcomes you have, and so on.
And trust is not just, this topic of trust is not just for conscious relationship. I have experienced in my life, especially lately, that trust is the biggest, I feel like one of the biggest virtue values or energies that I'm tapping myself into, that the more I trust myself, that I'm supported in the in this infinite universe, the more I'm feeling it, the more miracles really happening in my life, the more manifestation, like attracting amazing speakers to this summer, just one of them, you know, that they just come. And also what I like to share with my clients is in an aspect of trust is when I come from a place of being safe, you know, be feeling safe within myself, because I have some people ask me, well, you trust me? Do you trust me? And I'm like, I don't even say yes or no many times. I just said, I feel safe within myself. I feel safe in my body. My body feels safe. I check in. My body feels good. And my body feels good. And because I have created also gray boundaries to be able to choose is, I, you know, if I welcome something or I don't welcome something. So I'm in my power of choosing, but I'm coming from a place of feeling safe. So trust and safety, I believe that they are like coming together and they come from the place. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So this has been amazing. And I've just been enjoying every minute of it. So we're going to wrap it up. I would like for you guys to share, where can we find you? How can people reach out to you? And what will be your final message to them?
Well, you can reach us at richardandnamaste.com.
Yes.
And also at theschoolofalchemy.love. Yes. Is where the School of Alchemy resides.
Yes, and we're available on social media everywhere. We have, we're on Instagram, we're on YouTube, we're on Facebook. If there is a social media thing, we're on it, and we're easy to find. If you just look up Richard and Namaste or Namaste More, you will find us.
Yeah.
We're the
yeah.
only ones. So, so we're easy, we're super easy to find. Yeah.
So what would I, as a closing thing, I think, you know, you can't possibly screw this up. You know, even though everybody tells you you can and everybody says that you're ineligible for future happiness and you're ineligible for this, you're ineligible for that, all that is garbage. You actually have great things on the other side of you. Like, fear is what keeps you from having the life that you want, the relationship that you want, the prosperity that you want in your life, being conscious in all these areas. So if we can take the steps, the baby steps in many cases, to eradicate the fear, what we find is on the other side is the life that we've always desired.
Thank you so much. Oh, great. So I appreciate you, our amazing audience, for watching today's episode. And I will see you next time. Have a great day, everyone.